Germany. He explained the story of the orbit of Mercury perfectly, also predicted gravitational waves, discovered about a year and a half ago, and many other phenomena. And now the important point. We know that Einstein's theory, as beautiful and accurate as it is, will also be replaced someday by an accurate theory. They're considered to be a confirmation of the deeper laws. They're constantly being applied as new experiments lay out themselves, and as new ideas are tested. And in fact, what we call the law of nature should really be called approximate laws of nature, because in any given time, we're only working with approximations. Even if there are final laws of nature, perfect laws of nature, at any one time, those few laws. And it is in this process of revision that we see the strongest difference between science and religion. As I've said, everything in the physical world is subject to laws, but we have only approximations of those ultimate laws which we're constantly revising. The beliefs and knowledge of religion coming either from the divine authority of the sacred books or from the transcendent experience are not subject to revision. They are not approximations. Religion does not revise itself in the way that science does. There is something that scientists believe that cannot be tested by the methods of science, and that is a principle I call the central doctrine of science. And that principle says that the physical world is governed by laws, that those laws are always true everywhere at every time in the universe. I call the central doctrine of science the doctrine, because despite its past success, it cannot be proven, no matter what laws we have. We can't be sure that tomorrow we might observe phenomena that is a miracle that just cannot be explained by any laws. Our faith in the doctrine is so strong that when we find physical phenomena that seem to be unknown, like the orbit of the planet Mercury, we don't abandon belief in the lawful universe. When it was found that the orbit of Mercury disagreed a little bit with Newton's theory of gravity, we did not attribute the discrepancy to something mysterious, to the action of a whimsical god, or something that was intrinsically unexplainable. We realized that our theory needed revision. And in fact, I can't imagine any event in the physical universe that would cause scientists to label it as a miracle, to abandon belief in a lawful universe. If this table started floating right now, scientists would look for some magnetic levitation or some other law that they hadn't yet discovered, but not a miracle. We're deeply committed to the simple doctrine. There's another belief in science that cannot be proven, and that is belief that there is a final theory that is perfect, that is beyond approximation. And many physicists find that theory. Such a belief does not emerge from science itself. In fact, the history of science shows constantly rising and rising and rising and rising. So belief in final theory is just a matter of faith. And the irony here is that even if we were in possession of the final theory, we wouldn't know it. Because as a matter of faith. In his book, Green Final Theory, the Nobel Prize winning physicist Stephen Weinberg writes, quote, "Our present theories are only of limited validity, still tentative and incomplete. But behind them, now and then, we catch glimpses of a final theory, one that would be of unlimited validity and in turn satisfactory in its completeness and consistency. My own guess is that there is a final theory, and we are capable of discovering it. A final theory is really an extension of the central doctrine of science. In sum, I would argue that despite the huge differences between science and religion in the way that knowledge is acquired, that both share a certain degree of faith, of belief, and commitment to the unproven. Science experimentally tests everything that it believes, with exception of the fundamental belief, the belief in the central doctrine of science. I wanted to end by talking about some of these issues in a more personal way and specific way, and that is my personal attitude towards that. One can argue that many of our religious and spiritual beliefs are motivated by the knowledge of our own impending death. We confront our own physical demise with invoking the eternal, the immortal soul, God, and so on. All material things are made out of atoms, molecules, and the energy that holds them together, and the forces and energies that hold them together. And atoms and molecules are part of the physical world. And according to the view of science, all material is governed by laws. Immortality is not allowed by the laws. Disembodied existence is not allowed by the laws. Insubstantiability is not allowed by the laws. I'm a materialist, as I said when I started, but I consider myself a spiritual person, so you might call me a spiritual materialist. So the question is, how does a spiritual materialist think about his own impending death? I believe that this distinction between life and death is overrated. I've come to believe that death occurs gradually through the diminishing of consciousness. And let me explain what I mean. According to the scientific view, we are made of material atoms and nothing more. In fact, to be precise, the average person is made out of about 7,000 trillion atoms. The totality of our tissues and organs compose of these atoms. And according to the scientific view, there's nothing else. To a vast, complex being, each of us human beings would appear as an assemblage of atoms, humming with our various electrical and chemical energies. To be sure, it's a special assemblage. A rock does not behave like a person. But the mental sensation that we experience is consciousness as thought, according to science, purely material consequences of purely material electrical and chemical interactions between atoms. And when we die, this special assemblage disassembles. The total number of our atoms in our body stay the same, but they are scattered about. Particularly special in these considerations is the brain. In the view of science, the brain is where our self-awareness originates, our self-identity, our ego, our consciousness,